Everybody lift your hands as we lift our voices. Come on, say, my God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Come on, say, he can move mountains.
He can move mountains.
Keep me in the valley.
Keep me in the valley.
Come on, say it, hide me from the rain.
Hide me from the rain.
That's it. My God is awesome.
My God is
come on,
awesome.
Heals me when I'm broken.
Heals me when I'm broken.
Strength where I've been weakened.
Where I've been weakened.
Forever he'll reign.
Forever.
Come on, you got it. My God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Gloria Mitchell with good news for you. Today, our title is Only Believe. Just a simple word. Only believe. I know sometimes we have trouble believing some things. People will say, oh, I don't believe that happened. Oh, I don't believe she did that. I remember once I was speaking at a church and I was sharing my testimony about how I got so many compliments with a bald head. And I was sharing how I had had chemo. And that chemo, I'll tell you, is a powerful shampoo. It just wiped all my hair off my head at one time. And when that happened, I was holding all my hair in my hands. And so just to demonstrate what I experienced, I was wearing a wig at the time I was giving that testimony. And as I shared with the congregation, I reached up and I slid that wig off my head. And people, yeah, I don't believe she did that. Well, I did it because I know that my God is awesome. That song you just heard, that was true. And so today I have a guest who's going to share with us something that God has done that's awesome in his life. And his name is Del Gerard. Hi, Del. How are you today?
I'm doing great, Gloria. How are you?
Great, thanks. Thank you so much for agreeing to join us because I understand that you have a new book.
Yes, I do, Gloria. I have a new book. It's actually not just myself, but 12 other co-authors, including the great Les Brown. So it's just a great honor, great honor.
Oh, can we see that book? Can we see the cover of that book just to make sure that we got it here? Oh, the name of the book is?
Living with Heart, Wellness from the Inside Out.
Okay, tell us about that experience of writing or getting that book published.
Well, actually, it's a compilation of all 12 of us plus Les Brown. And what we did, everybody wrote a chapter. And so I was asked to do a chapter. It's on holistic wellness, health, and healing. And so we believe that everybody has something in their life that they can achieve. Sickness and disease hits us all the time. But we have choices that we can make in our lives that can help ourselves continue to be healthy, including the Word of God. And so when they asked me to do this one chapter, I was just honored. And I said, okay, I'll do it. And so we had the book come out on Amazon Kindle on Thursday. The book went number one.
Thursday?
So this past Thursday.
What was that, April or March 31st,
That's March.
2016.
March 31st, 2016, the book went number one. So it's kind of nice because now I can say I'm a best-selling author of the book.
All right.
So it's just really great to do it. It is a book.
Okay. Well, Del, I understand that you co-authored this book along with 12 others and Les Brown.
Yes.
So would you share with us what it is that you were asked to write in that book?
I was asked to write about our beliefs. Breakthrough to good health, our beliefs. One of the things that we have that we don't know, we have the power to change our lives by what we believe.
Oh, really?
Really?
Oh, you reminded me of something. I want to play a song right now. Oh, I'm excited to hear this. I want to play a song by Roy Hamilton, I Believe. Listen, please.
Of rain that falls, a flower grows. I believe that somewhere in the darkest night, a candle glows. I believe for everyone who goes astray, someone will come to show the way. Oh, I believe above the storm, the smallest prayer will still be heard. I believe that someone in the great somewhere hears every word. Every time I hear a newborn baby cry or touch a leaf or see the sky, then I know why
I believe that song is something that everybody should hear. Because when we look around, there is always something that we can question. But the Bible tells us that God created everything. And then he also tells us that we can all be saved simply by believing. In John 3, verses 16 and 17, the Bible says this, and I want to read it to you from the scriptures, even though I kind of memorized it. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." And to be saved, all we have to do is to believe that Jesus is God's only begotten Son. And I know that we recently celebrated Resurrection Sunday. And so, Del, you wrote about believing so that we could have a healthier life. Would you tell us what you really kind of included? Give us a summary of what you put in your book, please, in that chapter that you wrote
I'd
about.
I'd be happy to. I actually started called The Power of Beliefs. I actually speak on stage about the power of your beliefs. No one will do anything above or beyond their own beliefs. So if you really look at it, your beliefs are what's going to set the path in any direction that you decide to take. So I even shared a little bit about an elephant and how elephants are raised, especially for the circus. They have this big double chain around their foot and their leg, and it's put like 42 inches in the ground. Well, that little baby elephant is going to try and try and try to pull that stake out. It's going to come to a place where it says, "I can't do it." In its own mind, it's going to think, "I can't do it." And at that point, it's going to make a decision based on what they believe that they cannot do it. At that point, the trainer takes them outside, puts a rope around the leg with a small wooden stake in the ground, and the elephant will not try. Why not? Defeated in the bondage of his own mind by what he believes. And a lot of us, we believe things that are simply not true, and we put ourselves in bondage to those beliefs, or what we call limiting beliefs. I like to call them beliefs that limit you, and it goes totally against what the Word of God says. I even put it in the book, and Jesus said when he was dealing with the man with his son, and he said, "Look, if you can believe, all things are possible to them who believe." And that's really what I'm coming from. where the place where I'm coming from. If you can believe it, you can achieve it in Jesus' name.
All right. I like that. I really do. I know I went, it was actually almost a year ago. I went to a Get Motivated seminar and Les Brown spoke. This was my first time hearing Les speak. And so I listened to him and he was saying, you got a story in you. You need to tell that story. And I got excited because I'd been writing the Garbage Man's Daughter book series for years, and because I had a story in me and I needed to tell it. I needed people to know that when a child's family falls apart, that child is really devastated. And people, parents or adults, are so busy nursing their own wounds that they don't have time to really care about what's going on with the children. They're busy moving them from house to house or place to place, trying to do those things that are required of them as parents. And so I said, I'm going to tell my story and I'm going to tell it from a child's perspective because I know what it is to come from a broken home. And then when I started, as I sat and listened to and he says, yeah, you could tell your story and you could make money telling your story. I went, what? Whoa, you mean somebody could pay me instead of me paying to tell other people what I've experienced? So I got excited. That excitement, let me tell you, it put me on a roller coaster ride. After I left the Les Brown seminar, Get Motivated, then I met R.V. Robinson. So I wanted to go learn how to speak so I could tell my story. And she is one who trains people to speak. And when I left her, then I went to Matt Browning because I met Matt Browning at R.V. Robinson's seminar. And so Matt then had these evolution seminars. And so I attended that. And then if I'm going to have a business in speaking, I needed to learn how to set up a business. And so Matt had a business summit. So I attended that. And when I left there, then I met Paul Mata. And I actually met him at Matt Browning's event. And I moved on to Paul Mata's financial seminars because if you have a business, then of course you need to manage your money, right? And then Paul Mata had Mike Wolf on as a guest. And Mike Wolf says, I help businesses. Just come on over on a third Tuesday night and meet with us and we'll help you get set up in business. So Mike Wolf then was someone that I went to visit and meet the people in his group. From there, I also met Ken Courtwright. Ken Courtwright had digital footprints. We live in the digital age, so we need to know how to handle anything that has to do with technology. So I went to digital footprints. And while there, I met Bernie Dorman from CEO Space. And so then I went to CEO Space, met all these great people. And then they were saying, Heis, you have to network if you're going to be successful in business. I'm really telling you some things here. And then from CEO Space, then I decided, okay, I need to settle somewhere. And that's when I went to Craig Dulswalt's Rockstar Bootcamp, a marketing bootcamp. Why just write the books and why just package your story if you can't actually get it out there in the market? So I found out how to promote my story by going there. And now I have one last thing that's on my list of things to do, and that is to go to Dr. James Key's story alchemy, so I can perfect my story. So I believed that Les Brown knew what he was talking about when he said it, and Les Brown put me on this roller coaster ride so that I could get everything in order so I could tell you my story. Now, okay, Dale, I didn't mean to tell all that, but there I went. So, and on that roller coaster ride is where I met Dale. Dale, you said you believe. You're telling us that we need to have faith, especially if it relates to the healing process. So would you tell us your testimony, please, about how you came to believe in Jesus the Christ?
I came to believe in Jesus at the age of 15. I grew up Catholic, and we went to, you know, I went to catechism on the weekends, did all that stuff, you know, made my confirmation by eighth grade, got into high school, didn't know anything because basically we were done, and got involved with Young Life, Christian organization. My cousin got me in there, and they went to camps, everything was great. But the next year when I went, something changed. So I was at a camp, it's a three-day camp, Woodleaf they called it, and this guy was talking about Jesus and talking in a way that I didn't understand. And I kept saying, what's he saying? What's he saying? What's he saying? I didn't know. But before I knew it, I had accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and went around the next 4 to 5 months in high school. And the guy that was the leader of Young Life, we are still friends today. He remembers that conversion. And, you know, you leave, but then you come back. And so I rededicated myself fully January 23rd, 1994. And that's where I've never looked back. And so every time I do something, I always, and you know this, mention the name of Jesus. And I want to tell a quick story to you about believing. We talked about you've overcome, Gloria's overcome with a bout with cancer. I did also as well. In my surgery, I had two of them. The first one was February 25th, 1987. The second one was November 4th. And if you look at me today, I look healthy. But if you really look at my shoulders, one of them is different from the other one. Can you decide? Can you
see it? I don't know. I will see. I'm looking. I don't know. Go
ahead. Actually, this one over here, I don't have a right shoulder. It's gone. But I believe that the Lord was with me. They told me when I wake up, I will not have a right arm. But I believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. And 2 days later when I woke up, I still had a right arm. Thank you, Jesus. So it's been 29 years, and I still play racquetball, and I am right-handed. So that's what got me to the place I believe. I don't care who you are. If you believe, and the strength of your belief, that will carry you for or against whatever it is you want in life. So I would tell you, look, whatever that you want, Les Brown and the rest of them will tell you, you have a choice. God gave you the free will right to choose. And in Deuteronomy 30, he says, choose life. I chose life. That's why I believe I'm here today.
Oh, I'm so glad you mentioned that, of that thing about having a choice. I know I went to the doctor feeling great for a regular checkup, and then I was told, you need to see a surgeon. And so I went, a surgeon? Oh, okay. So I went to see the surgeon, and the surgeon says, we have discovered we're going to do an aspiration. We're going to aspirate your breast. Okay. So then he says, well, we see something here. And so do you want to have a lumpectomy or a mastectomy? And I don't want to have either one of those. No, thank you. So I didn't even know what he was talking about. And plus, I was wondering, why do I go from getting a physical to go seeing a surgeon? Why a surgeon? And so when I was given that choice, then I had, at the time, I had a young daughter who was 8 years old, and my daughters are 17 years apart. And I thought, well, if I do have breast cancer, then maybe God spaced those girls so that the older one could take care of the younger one. So I said, well, I don't want to die, but I don't want to have surgery either because I feel fine. I had no symptoms. I did not know that breast cancer was a silent killer. I'm talking to someone right now because sometimes we take things for granted that our health is always there. We don't feel anything. It's not what we see or what's going on the outside. It's what's on the inside of us that really counts. And that's the same way with our emotions and all those other things that we allow to accumulate inside, like ill feelings, like anger and bitterness and resentment. And I suppose, this is my own interpretation, that I allowed that to fester because I was a child of divorce and I had divorced. And so I researched that topic and I encountered so many people who had experienced the pain of divorce. And I saw that emotional trauma could actually cause tumors and ulcers and all kinds of other things that I call garbage to build up inside of us. And we have to let it go. And so I was thinking, well, I'm just not going to do anything. I will just pray about it. Well, I want you to know sometimes we have to do more than pray about something because God works through doctors. So while I was praying about it, God gave me a scripture one morning. One Good Friday, I woke up and I had an appointment to go see the surgeon. And so I'm going, well, Lord, I really don't want to go. But I have a friend. I have this dear friend. If I call her, if she answers the phone, which she usually never answered the phone on the first time I call, if she answers the phone and I ask her to go with her and she says yes, then I'll go see the surgeon because I didn't want to go alone, right? So I called her. I couldn't believe it. She answered on the first ring and she agreed to go with me. And so when I went to see the surgeon, she says, you know, the x-rays show that there's something, there's a mass on the left side. She said, but I know, now we're going a step beyond believing. She said, I know that there's something on the right side. And so I believed what she said. I trusted the surgeon. And she said, I said, but I really don't know if I should have a mastectomy or a lumpectomy. And that's why I'm here to get a surgical biopsy. I wanted to verify that I did, in fact, have breast cancer. Well, she said, all right, I see what the x-ray says and I know what I feel. And she says, I will put you at ease. I will go in, do the surgical biopsy, and then I'll let you know what your options are. Well, when I felt her poking at me, poking at my body, and when I woke up, she said, I think I got it all. And sure enough, she got it all, because that was 22 years ago that I had that lumpectomy performed, and I never had to make the choice. I struggled with it, but God used her, Dr. Grafton, to bless me by doing what only he could do. And then before I left that day for that surgery, I want to share this passage, and I'm sharing it from the Bible, from John 11:4. I like to read it so you'll know I didn't make it up. John 11:4 says, when Jesus heard that Lazarus was sick, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Well, that morning, that Good Friday that I went in for the surgical biopsy, this is a passage of scripture that came to mind. The Lord says, this sickness is not unto death. So when I went to see the surgeon for the surgical biopsy, I knew I wasn't going to die. Whatever I went through, I knew I wasn't going to die because God said it, and God needed to keep his word to me. And I'm telling you, I'm a living witness that if you will only believe, all things are possible if you only believe. Let's hear Elvis sing that song right now, Only Believe.
if you're lonely, believe. I met God one morning.
Tell us how believing in Jesus Christ has made a difference in your life.
Yes, Gloria. Well, for me, Jesus Christ has made a huge, huge difference. From the time that I was born, I've always believed in God, but I didn't really know anything about Jesus. When I came to really understand who Jesus was and what the Bible actually said about him, that's when I changed my life. That doesn't mean everything went well, but here's what I know. He said, in this life, you will have troubles, but be of good cheer because I have already overcome. And that's what I've seen in my life. Lots of things, lots of challenges, a lot of things that I would not want for my life. But because I put my trust in him, I overcame every single one of them. Not just the two bouts that I had with cancer, but also I'm talking about pulmonary embolism where they misdiagnosed me. For 3 weeks, thought I was having a heart attack. I told him I ain't having no heart attack and had to bring myself back in there and tell him where the problem was, and God still healed me. And so when they said, oh, you got to go through all of this drugs that you have to be on for the rest of your life. Well, guess what? I said, what's the minimum? They said, the minimum's 1 year. After 1 year, guess what? I'm off. I've already had, even this earlier this year, I had to go through because they said, well, you got this little extra beat in your heart. I went and checked that out. Did the atomic stress test. Got my results back, everything's clean. No blockage in the arteries, nothing. Why? Because Jesus has helped me. Believing makes a difference. Believing in Jesus Christ makes a difference. He said, prove me wrong. So guess what I'm gonna tell you? If you're going through things in your life, if your life is going down a path that you'd rather go down a different path, I'm gonna tell you a couple things. Number one, you have the right to choose which direction you wanna go. And if you don't have the strength to do it alone, there's one person that says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will never let you down. And that's my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And he has never done that. I encourage you to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Not that your life will be perfect.
Amen.
But that he will be there every step of the way.
Okay, and one last thing. Del, would you please share how people can get in touch with you if they'd like to hear more?
The easiest way to get in touch with me so people remember, I got in a new email, coachdel@gmail.com. Coach, C-O-A-C-H, Del, D-E-L, one L, like Del Taco, for those who know what Del Taco is, without the taco, coachdel@gmail.com. It's the easiest way to get a hold of me.
And what do you do, Del?
I'm a business coach. I'm a life coach. I'm also a speaker, which is where I met Gloria, and I'm a minister of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
All right. Well, Del, I thank you so much for sharing with us. And one more time about your book, the title of your book. Well, could we see the book again, please, for those? Okay. The title is
Living with Heart.
Living with Heart. And so kudos to you for teaming up with Les Brown and the others, and we're expecting to hear great things. Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, we do have a website also, livingwithheartonline.com. livingwithheartonline.com. If you also want more information about all the speakers, there's bios about each and every one of us, and we will be putting together places where we will go speak as a group.
Well, if you missed this broadcast, or you know someone who missed it who needs to hear it so they can be encouraged, because that's what Good News for You is all about, we invite you to send them to rmcgospel.com and click Watch Replay. I thank you so much for listening. May the good news bless your heart. Remember, Jesus loves you, and I'm praying for you. And have a blessed day.
Me from the rain. Has he ever covered you? Come on, my God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Heals me when I'm broke.
Heals me when I'm broke.
Strength where I've been weakened.
Forever
he'll reign. One word. Come on, everybody.
My God is awesome.
Come on, somebody lift your voice. The whole world.
Savior of the whole.
Giver of salvation.
Giver of salvation.
By his stripes.
By his stripes
I'm healed. Yeah, my God is awesome.
My God is
listen,
awesome.
Today I am forgiven.
Today I am forgiven.
His grace is why
grace
I'm living.
Is why I'm living.
Somebody ought to praise his holy name. Come on, you say, my God. You're from
awesome.
Let's talk about why he's awesome. You said.